Last time on the 40-40.
We're about ready to probably step into one of the wildest, adventurous, and challenging seasons of our lives.
Today was our first day of our 40-day course, and one of the huge components of that is throwing food.
Fit all this butter.
Yeah?
Pretty gross.
Yeah.
Throwing 1,500 meals was kind of surreal. Like, looking at all the bins, I was like, we are going to eat all that and carry that.
You going on this trip, yeah, it's going to launch you into new places with the Father. There's going to be so much upgrade that happens. But in the end, you got to know that the upgrade that happens isn't only about you. It's about the Father's glory.
Up and it was just time to take off. We're all kind of nervous about it, but we say our goodbyes to civilization and jump in the van.
I was just really excited to actually be able to start our adventure. I've been waiting since September, and finally we're actually out and doing it.
Woo-hoo! My first thoughts when we get to Beehive is actually really excitement because we finally get out of the building and into the field.
It was kind of surreal. Okay, the moment I step out of this van, I now am going to be out here for over a month.
So, today, here's our main objective. It's to lay the foundation for the next 40 days. We do things that, you know, like intro to wilderness talk, four essentials that we always carry around. Because I'm going to introduce you guys to our three essentials. Anytime we go to a climbing place for a night hike or a day. Or... First essential, could anybody guess?
Water.
Water. Good. Second essential? Sunblock. Third essential is a super important one.
Rain gear.
Close. Rain gear.
You said it, Will.
Nice. Information can seem overwhelming, but we actually get to be out in the backcountry. You get a pretty good idea on the first day how the rest of the trip is going to go.
We have about a 3-mile hike.
Since it's the beginning of our trip, it was important for us to have help on with our packs.
All right, guys, let's load up.
The backpacks are really heavy. Mine was especially heavy because I was carrying a bunch of camera gear and like the solar panel and batteries. The way we would do it is have someone go up behind us, grab the pack, lift the pack up, and then we would put the straps on.
Your backpack is a storage unit of all the equipment you need for the next 40 days, and they're heavy. We just don't want people straining their backs or straining a muscle.
When we're hiking, one of the things we want to be conscious for is hot spots. What's a hot spot?
Blisters form from friction with our shoes and stuff, and so hot spots form, which is right before a blister, rubbing area where a lot of friction is, and it warms up. So they call it a hot spot, and it does start to hurt, you know.
Be aware of it and let us know.
There had been a lot of preparation for this trip, and it was a weird moment, like actually taking the first step on a long journey.
Down the trail.
The trail, here we go.
We're finally off hiking, and we're heading up our first few miles up a steep hill. Even though it wasn't that long of a hike or that hard of a hike, you know, it's still the first day, and I had not really been getting in shape for that hike.
Brake lights.
You had to kind of pay attention to the person right in front of you because I usually watch their feet. And so as soon as I see them stop, it's too quick and you just kind of run into it. So I had several hits to the head with the backpack.
It's kind of like a line of marching ants. You know, I liked to be in the back because you could kind of put as much space between you and other people that you needed. But like if you're right in the middle, right behind somebody, and if they stop for any reason or slow down, like your face just runs right into the pack. That happens way too often.
We are hiking in very close proximity to one another. Maybe later we spread out, maybe not.
It's just another one of the hardships of being in the wilderness.
On the trail, like you have hours of time of just hiking, so you kind of want to break out some icebreaker questions, you know, just get to know people a little bit more. And I was just asking Sean kind of what his favorite food was.
Dude, I love cheesecake. You can't go wrong with cheesecake.
I was right in front of Matt and Sean, and I'm like, you guys, don't be talking about this stuff. We're about to go 40 days in the wilderness, and you're talking about luxury food.
Let's not have this conversation in 20 days, though. Talking about food when you're hungry sucks.
I'm actually kind of... What about sex breakfast?
I know we had one breakfast, but what about second breakfast?
I don't think he knows about that.
Well, we hadn't been hiking for long until we had to stop and take a break. Merritt started getting a hot spot, which was, it was just not good, especially it being that soon.
So we took a little break to get her patched up, which is good because we had like, I don't know, 5 woofers to help her. So they were all really excited to take care of a hot spot.
So the woofer is a wilderness first responder, just a medical certification that usually backcountry people get.
And that wrapping tape over it in there?
Okay.
Right there?
Yeah.
That would be it. Is that the only heel, Mary?
No, it's the other one too.
Okay.
Now, I came from Michigan, and that is at sea level, and then started hiking at about, what is it, 8,200 feet? So I was not feeling so hot. I was not in shape. I think a few times I took my pack out and maybe did a few like walks around the lake back in Michigan, and that did not cut it for the high altitude here. So that was struggle busting for sure.
The first hike was gorgeous. I've never really seen a place like Beehive before. Being from California, I've known, you know, I've hiked around in the Sierras. Beehive was just so different.
It was beautiful country. It was just good to like see like the vastness of Wyoming, the openness of it, like, and then to see far off rock formations here and there, just speckled across.
Whenever we get off trail, we do spread across meadows.
Everybody had to go from being a single file line to just fanning across this big meadow.
That's kind of the best leave no trace ethic. If you hike in a line of people walking across a meadow, you automatically will start creating an unnecessary trail. They're called social trails. And we want to avoid that. We want to keep meadows and areas pristine and the original condition.
Towards the end, we got into like an aspen grove where there's a lot of river flowing through and stuff like that. So it was a little bit hard, like going through this like marshy, like bushy place.
The hike had been so easy that day up until that point that none of us really expected to have trouble. But there were many times when I was just so close to taking a dive into just this swamp. When that's the hardest part of your day, you can't complain about too much, I guess.
They were so good. They are brand new.
We just arrived at our campground in Beehive.
The first part of our campsite that we find is called the kitchen. And that's where we obviously prepare our food, and that's where we'll have our community like depots and stuff.
And from there, we kind of want to keep our tents like 300 feet away for the bears. And then we want to keep our bear hangs like 300 feet away from that. And so you kind of build a little triangle going on there, you know, tents, kitchen, and then bear hangs. Bears aren't really that prevalent in Beehive, but something that you just start practicing now, because in the winds, there actually is going to be grizzlies and other bears.
Next, you're going to identify where people are going to sleep, campsites.
Went over campsite selection, like how, what to look for, what to avoid when trying to find a good place for your tent.
So we want to stay away from dead trees like this, mostly ones back behind us with brown and don't look so good. We want to stay away from these because high winds can knock these over. If we're standing underneath this, it'll kill us. That's why they call them widowmakers. So we want to try to stay 10 feet away from the farthest falling point.
We noticed like all the trees were dead, and it was kind of spooky, like we were in a scary forest.
If you've noticed, you've been seeing like all these random brown. The dead trees were very shocking, to be honest. The Rocky Mountain region has been experiencing a major epidemic of what's called beetle kill. They're these little, only a couple millimeters in size. They crawl in these trees, and there's some chemical they put off on these beetles that ends up killing the trees, and it kills them very rapidly within the course of months. And the entire West is experiencing this.
Like it has more of like an almost like a cork type picture right now.
The reason why we're having a beetle
epidemic right now is because we've suppressed fire so well.
Due to fire suppression as well as the kind of some global warming and lack of an extreme cold for a certain amount of time, we're seeing a lot of beetle kill in the Rocky Mountains. So it's making the Rocky Mountains very difficult.
That coming down, that's a lot of force.
We train our students, if they're in an area where there's a lot of beetle kill, they look down, then they look up, make sure there's no dead trees around, and if they are, they're gonna have to find a different place than that. So the beetle kill is a very serious problem in the West. It's changing the West. Nobody knows what it's gonna look like in the future. So it's a privilege to have been able to see the forests the way they have been, and they are gonna be changing.
This is not a bad spot. It's a little bit lumpy, but it's...
So after Matt gave us our tent selection, we went and found our first new campsite. Meg and I were in the tent together.
There used to be so many more options back in there before, but
this
now
is
we kind of need
to me.
Even
so
since
sad.
Last year. This is true. Let's pray against these beetles.
In Jesus' name! Keep going.
I don't know what this is for.
I've never really set up a Black Diamond Mega Mid before, so getting used to it is a bit tricky.
Or one state.
I think it goes in the...
There are some things in life that you look at the pieces, and you just don't see how they're supposed to go together. And our tents, the Mega Mids, is one of those things.
Learning to set up your Mega Mid is always... an ongoing process. Students forget the knot called the trucker stitch, how to put in a stake a particular way, and so that's always going to be interesting. Then over time, they'll find setting up mega mids is a learned skill set, and at times it'll be really hard, especially with all the snow
master.
Conditions.
Master rope.
So that was a little bit tricky, but once you got the hang of it, it was real simple. It's just one single pull in the middle, and then you're just tying off to your stakes. Or your rocks and stuff like that. Why do they have to call them steaks? You know, you're out here in the wilderness and all you really want is some good food. And steak makes me think of having a steak, you know? But it's so funny, I was like, oh yeah, Robbie, you have the steaks? He's like, steak?
Again, no yard sales in the
poster up. Make it more like home.
Mayor, she seems like a great person and a fun character. She's very a joking, lively spirited person. We set up our Mega Mids and she talks about putting up a Justin Bieber poster, like the Titanic stuff, and it was just funny. Just be able to see who she is, you know, see the real side of her.
You want to see my doggy?
Show me how to doggy.
I just don't know if I'm ready yet.
Man, show me how to doggy, man.
I don't even know you guys that well.
Yeah, I want to see a doggy.
Only you show me the doggy.
Doggy?
Doggy. Yeah, the doggy.
The doggy. Not today. Sorry. Maybe when my blisters go away.
Will had probably the most interesting school. I'm glad we nominated him.
I was thinking of creation. It's like most everything has a tail. We don't have tails. I just asked God the answer to this question. And I was just sitting there, just wondering, you know, I flew to the toilet, listened for an answer, it was real loud, nothing came. And I thought, I finished my business up, I stood up. You know, sometimes stand up, you gotta go again, you're like, all right. And that's when the answer came, that silence, I had to wait. So I go back down, I'm like, God gave us man the ability to grow a tail. And I was like, we can grow a tail about once, maybe even twice a day. Some people, you know, every other day. And I got sad. And I was like, I have to grow a tail inside. You know, all the animals are all outside growing a tail. And I was just like, how does this work?
At first, I have to admit, I didn't know where he was going with his little intro story. But about the tail, and then I get it.
I found the answer.
Stanley.
I was sitting there with a note. First one, we had a verse. Deuteronomy 23:12. Designate a place outside of the camp where you can go relieve yourself.
It may have taken me a little while to make the connection between Stanley and its biological function representation.
It was great to see that he actually had some biblical support. It was a good talk. You know, something you need to take care of. Because if you don't, it'll take care of you.
The first thing of Stanley, you can't just take him and use him. You have to walk around with him. He's really needy. So you got to walk about 5 minutes outside of camp before you can even use him.
The word Stanley refers to the shovel or the gardening spade used to dig a hole for the process. It's a cute little nickname. And Stanley is supposedly our friend.
Number two, Stanley is a clean freak. So you always have to bring your hand sanitizer with you. And he never touches your tail, ever. He doesn't like sticks, he uses a stick to move it. So, dig your hole, do your hand sanding, fill the hole back up. Is anyone here who's never pooped in the woods before?
I haven't.
Who's a veteran? I'm guessing Josh and Amy. You want to share with us one of your moves?
Ooh, Josh has some good ones for you.
Show us one good move, we'll go around, everyone can come up for it. Okay.
My go-to move, usually it comes pretty quick, is the tripod. So it's kind of like... So why doesn't everybody tripod? Right,
tripod it up.
Let's tripod it up. You got the right hand. You're like, oh man.
What if it's runny?
It's runny?
Then it goes on your hand.
You have a hole.
What? That would have to be really runny. Well, then, okay, if it's runny, you're like, oh no, I gotta switch hands. Do the switch. So that's one of my favorites.
Leave No Trace is a set of principles that people use to minimize their impact in the outdoors. So, you know, there's a really obvious kind of picture of L&T where, yeah, if I toss my toilet paper on the ground after I go poo, then it's a blatant, obvious disregard for the area and the creation I have and the people around me, right? But then there's just like little things that you don't really think about too much that can also have an impact. You know, you're cooking your food and you drop maybe like, you know, 5 grains of rice, you know, not that big of a deal, right? Just 5 grains of rice. But what if our cook group does that and your cook group does that and your cook group does that, and then we've got, you know, a few little piles of rice around here, and then the next team, 40-40 team is gonna come by. Or even, you know, aside from Strom, you know, some other people will come by to camp, and we always wanna try to leave the areas that we go to looking better than when we were there. If you think of the greater picture of God's creation being something that not only is his creation, but he takes pleasure in it, it glorifies him. You know, there's that verse that says that all of creation cries out to God. Like, creation gives God praise. It's destroying a piece of God's glory. Christians sometimes have this tendency to kind of back away from L&T and stuff like that because there's, you know, oh, that's that environmentalist thing. We as Christians should be the best practitioners of L&T ever. If it's, you know, a piece of God's glory, then how much more do we not want to destroy that? You know, there's also just the respect of other people too. The places in the winds that you guys would go to later are places that hardly anybody ever goes. Like, there'll be some of the very few people that ever go there. So it's just like super, super pristine areas that, you know, if we destroy, we're disrespecting the other people that will follow us.
Are we gonna freak out about every little thing? No, it's a conscientious mindset that's saying, hey, I'm out here, I want other people to see the reflection of God's glory should they pass through here as well. That's all it's about.
I'm coming with you, man.
Three ingredients that your food is divided up into. So first is gonna be proteins, carbohydrates, and then fats is number three. So all three of those are very essential in order for our bodies to not just survive out here, but thrive. We wanna eat well. As a food group, you're gonna be like, what do we wanna cook? The point is you're gonna wanna plan ahead as far as the meals that you want to have.
My first cook group was a yellow group. It was a peanut allergy group.
Hey Stephanie, what's for dinner on day one?
We're making gado gado with sunflower butter. I'm just
gonna, do you know what gado gado is?
Not really. What is it again?
It's gado gado.
Gado gado.
Gotta get me some.
They were really fun. That was such a good way to start out. The cooking experience, but learning it with Matt and Megan and Sean, they were just awesome.
I wouldn't put chocolate chips in every ration. I just want to know that.
Why are we not? Why are there not?
How did we not put that together?
That on here.
I don't know. Okay. We need to start thinking. You can't just listen to everything they say.
We were in the yellow group, and there's also the blue group and the tan group, and then the instructors group.
Our first cook group was pretty professional.
Some nice chowder, and we're gonna couple that with a little bit of, what is it, curry rice.
I was with Tasha and Anthony, and it was a good thing that all three of us liked the sort of the same tastes, and we're all pretty talented, I'll just say that.
Not curry rice, curry.
I thought it was curry.
Mealtime's really fun because, I mean, it's just such a team effort, and like, people are always playing around, trying to make different recipes and things like that, and ends up just being completely terrible most of the time. But it's you know, you still enjoy it, and it's fun. And
instead of doing my testimony in words, I'm going to do an interpretive dance to act out my life. I'll begin with birth.
Being a huge fan of interpretive dance as a medium, I really appreciated her emotion, interpretation of her life, and it really spoke to me.
That's all I got right now.
That's good testimony.
Okay, thank you.
What about this situation?
Birth, born, and then born again.
What about this
way
situation?
We clean our stuff. These things are your best friend.
I mean, not good. No, like,
use your scraper. It's got like a rubbery side and the hard side. Yes, and you're scraping it and eating it. And then your final step is to put just like a little bit of water.
Something it. Put the water in, mix it up, and then you drink it up. All that goodness. No goodness goes to waste in the backcountry.
It's also a way of cleaning.
In the beginning, it's hard to set something, yes. But you kind of get used to it.
Oh, yeah, it looks pretty clean to me.
That's refreshing, man.
Oh, yeah, see, there we go. That's what we got. Oh, yeah. Down the hatch.
Down the hatch.
Oh, yeah. So good.
So good.
Best part is that crunchy part at the end when you get the little particles.
Yeah. Those are awesome. Love it.
Hot chocolate?
What dessert should we make?
Being out in nature and God's creation is wonderful. And I've actually never worshipped in the woods before, and to actually be able to do that for the first time was a little bit strange in the beginning, but it seemed more natural. Just being out in God's creation and worshipping the Creator, it was a blessing.
Scripture says make a joyful noise. So we want to challenge you guys today to ask the question, Lord, am I an echo or am I a voice unto you in giving you glory?
There is a big difference between having your own voice before the Lord as a worshiper and being an echo. And one of the most important things we do on this 40 is teaching students and individuals how to plug in to the Father, and that the Father is their source. And one of the ways we do that is learning how to be a worshiper with your lifestyle.
Because a lot of us in the American culture we've grown up in, I'm not saying it's bad, but we've been able to ride on the coattails of other people and their anointings, their gifts, and their talents. So if this guitar got broken, right, would you still be somebody who's just constantly, Father, I praise you, I worship you today, giving him glory? You want to be a voice to the Father.
How many experienced just kind of a rough night last night?
That first night, a lot of people had like weird dreams and stuff like that, and I had a weird dream too.
That's over half.
It's kind of interesting that there's sort of that spiritual battle going on.
You know, last night the Lord really started something, and there really is an enemy out there, and he hates you with a passion, and he's going to do everything he can to stop. And if he can't stop, he's going to do everything he can to suffocate what God wants to do. So if you were really feeling that attack last night, what we're going to do now is we're going to just cover ourselves with the blood of Jesus. Whenever somebody is oppressed or depressed or they're just stuck in life, a lot of times you can drop back to a place where covenant was broken. And the only way to fix broken covenant is to apply the blood of Jesus. Because the blood of Jesus is what reestablishes covenant with God the Father. So we come to God the Father through Jesus Christ by the Holy Spirit. Because covenant is what broke the power of the enemy. Satan can't stand the blood. The blood of Jesus is, well, Jesus is the highest authority in the universe. And scripture says that he carries all authority, power, and dominion in every title that can be given in this present age and the age to come. And that is why we want to take the broken things and put them back under covenant through the blood of Jesus so that they are repaired.
The enemy just hates where you're going. When you start stepping into becoming a son of God, a true legitimate son that knows their Father in heaven, he hates that. And so let's say no. Enough's enough. We're not gonna allow this, right? So why don't you guys get in the middle? Jesus, right now. And in Jesus' name, we take authority over every lying spirit that would come against them right now. We take authority over every condemning spirit that would remind them of their past.
Let's just do a quick praise song and open up with prayer. Okay, here we go, chorus.
I exalt thee. I exalt thee. I exalt
and Lord, we just want to commit this day into your hands, Father. We ask that you would distinguish this time with your presence, Lord. We plead the blood of Jesus over our bodies, souls, and spirits, Lord. We ask that you would...
Well, it was our first night in the woods last night. Today, woke up nice and early because we're going to go do some climbing.
And we're going to be climbing the Beehive today, so super excited, especially since I've climbed before and just excited to go out and do what I love.
Man.
All right, guys, pull out your harnesses.
We had to do like a ground school to learn like how to do everything. Yes.
We're going to do in the horizontal what we'll be doing in the vertical later.
So it's horizontal rock climbing, teaching people how to rock climb, how to tie their knots, teaching people how to use the signals.
Perfect. Now we're going to enter into our verbal contract, and it goes like this.
On belay?
Belay on.
On belay, belay on, climb on, up rope, all of the kind of signals to create a safe environment. These are universal signals that are used all over the world. And basically we do it on the ground so that people are learning what it feels like to climb safely, to belay.
All right, now you're gonna initiate the end of the contract.
Belay off.
All right, off belay.
Oh. All right.
To belay your partner, which is essentially to put them in a place where if they fall, you're catching them on the other end of the rope. And we do all that on the ground so that people go through an entire scenario of what it looks like. They tie their figure eight, they tie their knots, and then we go and put it into practice on the actual vertical rock. And they have a feeling of what it feels like because they practice it in a safe environment on the horizontal ground. And today's ground school was awesome.
It was really, you know, a fun way to learn and, you know, got to mess around a little bit. Got pretty crazy on one of those ground school climbs.
Oh, Robbie, good one! Good one! Oh, Cruxy, Robbie, you got this.
That was cool.
So today we took our group of students out to a place called the Beehive, which is a climbing area in Beedaboo, which is also known as the Boo. You'll hear us refer to it as the Boo, a climbing area that has world-class crack climbing.
So rubber on these shoes just has super special formulas. You know, stick to rock really, really well. The way rubber sticks to rock, though, is through pressure. If you're not putting pressure on your shoe, it's not going to stick.
So, like, if I have, like, a little tiny nick right here,
and if I'm going like this, and, like, oh, I don't really trust that, not really, like, putting pressure on it, that's just going to pop off. So I'm going to go, okay, I'm going to put my foot there, I'm going to get it in the good spot, and then I'm actually going to step up onto it. So it'll totally stick like that.
I'm just checking out her ropes to make sure, like, her rope is tied in correctly, and
it's neat.
Yeah, and that's neat. What knot is that, Josh?
It's a crazy eight.
Figure eight.
Figure eight. What is it? This is just a 5-7.
5-7 is a rated climb. It starts off at anything with a rope is going to start off at like 5.0, and it's going to go up different points, like decimals. And after you get to like a 5-10, you're going to start going 5-10 A, B, C, D as well. And like A, B, C, D, then go up to 5-12.
Yeah.
As an instructor, it is a lot of fun. to take students on their first day of climbing. Some of the students have had the opportunity to climb indoors before, but it's a whole nother game and just a dimension of the sport to be able to do outdoors. Having to really use your body in different ways and look for the best place to climb and specifically trust your feet a lot more.
It's interesting to see the varying accomplishments of people and just like their different skill levels. We've got some people who are starting like in the beginners and some people are really accomplished. Cool, we've got some guys over here who are doing like 5.11s or something crazy like that.
I've done a little bit of climbing before, so I was feeling pretty confident. I'd done some climbing before and kind of wanted to start off with something a little bit harder. Just jump right in. It was a lot harder than I remembered, but.
Vitavu climbing is more foot oriented in its sport climbing. And so you're having to trust your feet. You're having to learn how to balance and use your body in different ways. And so it's a lot of fun to take students out for the first time, and the Beehive is a great area to learn. There's a lot of intermediate and introductory climbing, and our group of students did awesome today.
Yeah! Yeah! Yummy!
Are you ready?
No, not yet.
Nice and slow.
I think there was a lot of people that conquered fears and just chose to really go for it.
This is going to be such a good challenge for him. I'm stoked he's getting on it. It's going to stretch him for sure.
We've done a good amount of climbing so far. Probably climbed 6 or 7 climbs. And, usually I can climb pretty well, but today, I think God's just serving me a little bit of humble pie. Not climbing the cleanest routes, but it's okay. We're having fun. It's a great time. I'm blessed for that. And hopefully I can get up this one.
Today was our first day of climbing, and my hands are already starting to get a little torn up. I did like 5.7 over on that. I was like just ready to take my shoes off at the top, but there's definitely something exhilarating about just kind of like conquering the rock, man over rock.
I was playing Will that day, and he actually twisted over his shoulder and actually popped his shoulder out.
Basically, there was a tricky move just over the ledge, and I came down, my shoulder just, my arm moves funny, and my shoulder popped out.
So it was dislocated, and then he ended up popping it back in.
Back in business.
What's he playing now?
I don't know, we have to talk to Josh. And see what he has to say. Just kind of feel it out, see how it goes. I don't know if we'll be able to do any more climbing this trip.
The injury had already occurred some months before and he just aggravated it again. So we're just going to continue to pray and press in that God's going to heal him completely, and that's not going to compromise anything on the course for him.
Kind of in the afternoon section, we did some harder climbing. I think it was a 5.11 kind of like climb that's in the corner, and you're kind of like bringing yourself out underneath this overhang and climbing up above. So that was just really difficult. Me and Sean gave a go at it.
Throw that left foot out.
Use that right foot. Come on, a little higher. Yeah. Oh!
Yes!
Get him,
Tao. There it is. Yup! Yeah. Don't stop! Yeah!
So that night, we had dinner, and then after that, we had our very first devotional.
So the first few days, we start with a devo called What's Your Story? And it's really important that we know one another's stories, because we need to know where people are so so that we can take them to where God is calling them to be.
Everybody has an actual, which is where they're at right now, and their past has helped cultivate and shape their actual. But they also have a potential, which is where God is calling them to in the future.
My sister and my mom and I moved from Florida when I was 2 weeks old to Illinois. My biological dad and mom got a divorce because he'd had an affair. And I met him a couple times. He always brought like his kids up, and it was hard, I guess, you know, the fact that he came, visited twice, but like brought the kids that, you know, he made with somebody else while we were at home when I was being born. So my mom was working on her master's, and she's a drug and alcohol counselor at a prison and worked long hours, and it was just awesome. She's so strong and everything, and my sister and I had a babysitter. And they became like family. And my babysitter's husband started sexually abusing us. My sister's 2 years older than me, so it started with her. And then it started with me when I was 5. Until I was in second grade when we moved. And I told my mom when I was in 5th grade, because that was kind of when it started dawning on me that like what happened wasn't right. When you're a child, you don't know. And so it started there, and we went through that whole process, and then it just wasn't talked about. I guess I held a lot of guilt for it as a child. I felt like I took responsibility for it because I should have stopped it, because at 5 I somehow knew how. And I even felt bad for sending the guy to prison, which is insane. I felt bad for making my mom feel guilty because she was such an amazing mom, and I felt bad for putting that on my family. This guy last summer, I remember when I told him, I was just bawling, and he just like wrapped his arms around me and like started praying, and like praying for healing in my heart and thanking God for me as a woman. And and it was the first time that I had talked about it and not felt ashamed. I remember just like sitting there and feeling like Jesus was holding me. And that it felt okay to be vulnerable, and it felt okay to be open about something. And at that moment, like I realized, like Jesus had felt that pain with me ever since I was 5. Like, it did not come from him, and that he took every step with me, even when I wouldn't take his hand, because he wanted to be there when I was willing to take that step. And that felt awesome, the fact that I could just feel his love. I could just feel him, like, being there for me and crying with me and empathizing with me. And it was so healing and cleansing. I just felt, I remember afterwards just feeling so pure again. I go through stages where I'm very vulnerable with God, and I'm very open, and I can just feel his grace and his love on me, and like I can just pour out my heart to him, and it feels really good. And then it's so easy to just shut myself off again. And so I guess I'm here because I just want to like consistently be able to be completely open to God's love.
Sharing my backstory was, you know, it's a little uncomfortable at first because you don't really open up to people like that, really. And I was a little bit more comfortable after hearing some of the other guys and girls. And I really related with Will's story. So.
Yeah, growing up as a kid, I was basically kind of, you know, the typical church kid. Nothing huge happened. I must ask God like 20 times in my heart, because I thought every time I screwed up, I'd do it again. It's like every altar call, I was bolted down there. Until one day I realized, like, oh, yeah, all right, I don't have to do this anymore. I moved up, like, with the older kids in football, and I stopped, you know, just started doing that instead of my other church things. I still went to Young Life, and if you ask, and then Young Life and stuff, but I started just, like, that year just started smoking weed just all the time. Just started, and it's progressed all throughout high school. And I was still, if you asked me, I'd be like, oh, yeah, I'm a Christian for sure. Like, I knew all the right answers. I knew all the stories. I went to Young Life and, like, would be like, oh, yeah, you know, I went to camps and just didn't feel any conviction over what I was doing at all. And that just kind of progressed up until, like, getting involved with hallucinogens and just, like, stronger things senior year, and just still just didn't see that anything was wrong with it. I was at a party with my friends at a lake house, and I just ended up getting obliterated. And I don't remember leaving the party. The next thing I know, I'm standing in front of my house with the cops. And turns out I drove home, my friend got out of the car at my house instead of his house, and was like, oh, like, can you take me home? And I was like, oh yeah, for sure. So we got in my car, I made it two blocks, and there was a right turn, and I went straight and I hit a house. And I just nailed this house and drove home, woke my parents up, and told them what had happened. And it was just the worst night of my life. Like, it was definitely like the biggest defining moment I've ever had. I don't know if you know, they turn the camera around on you when you're in the back seat of your car. And I had to watch this with my lawyer. And I just ended up just exploding, like, to God. Just, I don't remember any of it. Just laying, just drunkenly, everything out on the table. And I was just watching this later. And just, it was really kind of weird seeing that. Just kind of what true feelings were that I had bottled up. But the best thing that happened out of that was it just opened a sweet conversation between me and my parents. Because they had thought, like, I would tell them all, like, the Christian stuff I was doing at school, but they had no idea about anything else. And so we were just talking, and I was like, you know, I want to change. I see these people, and I want to be like them. And they were like, well, you can't do it by yourself. Like, you have to give it to God. And I just said, you know, I have my friends here. There's no way I'm growing at all with my friends here and just this environment. My mom just said, looked at me and goes, pray for new friends. I was like, yeah, whatever, all right. We sat down and prayed for new friends. 2 days later, we get a call from the same lady that called on me for getting me in trouble for smoking weed and doing drugs, saying, hey, I heard what happened. I kind of know where Will's at. I think you should go on a trip with Campus Crusade for Christ this summer to San Diego, California. And I was just like, yes, like, this is what I want. Like, I love the beach, I love surfing, I want to go out there and just, you know, take everything in and grow. And that just was a complete life change that summer after my freshman year. And I got involved with youth back this last year, and it was just amazing. It was Inner City Ministries, and they just completely accepted me. I had my interview, and I was real scared, telling them, you know, this is my past. And he was like, it's no big. Like, there's just people on staff that have had, you know, done stuff like that. You know, I've gotten these things. I was like, awesome. So I was able to talk to him, like, these people who just fully, like, forgave me for what had happened, and just knew, like, took me as a new person. And kind of made my life clear. I want to do something with, like, or gave me more of a heart for, like, inner city kids, inner city ministries, and which has been really cool. And I've always had a heart for the outdoors. Like, I'm an Eagle Scout, and I thought, what better way to, like, get these kids, like, outside? Like, we take them wakeboarding with us, and they've never been to a lake before. You get him out on a tube on the boat, and just the biggest thug kid, just the biggest grin on his face, is just so crazy to watch. That's kind of what brought me here. And I just want to grow from being just, like, more of a kid in, like, college, and to being more of an adult, like, after this. Once I go my senior year and go out and get a real job, and just God really show me what it is, like being a disciple, to, like, a discipler, someone that can pour out my life into people.
Something that kind of seems like a general theme is our brokenness. A lot of us have come from rough pasts. There's nothing really we can do to earn God's love. Will talked about his backstory. He made the interesting decision of actually cutting off his dreads.
And so you just feel like
don't know. I just feel like it's what I'm supposed to do.
I know he was growing it for 2 years or something like that. I guess he just thought of it as an act of obedience towards God. And that was really cool and really powerful.
You understand that the issue is the heart.
Yeah, drugs are not a sin.
Yeah, I think it's definitely been like...
Drugs are cool, but yeah.
He shared with us that he had, for years, you know, just really kind of babied them and pampered them. But that the Lord, during our devotional tonight, spoke to him and specifically said, I want you to cut these dreadlocks off.
I've definitely idolized them in a way. Something that I've put higher than I should have.
Well, we're going to agree with you right now, man.
Yeah.
In Jesus' name.
Yeah.
Kind of taking the next step in his, like, walk and his manhood and things like that.
So we took the shears out of the first aid trauma kit. And, I mean, we're not beauticians, but just... in love and faith along with him and prayer and support, we just cut them all off. And so you're going to see a new will from here on out.
Yeah, we thank you that you bring us in divine order, that you're more concerned about our hearts than anything else. You love us so much, and there's nothing better than giving our lives unto you.
It just reminds me of all the times in the Bible when this is a thing.
This is real.
This is an actual thing. Always been a symbol of, you know, the progression of God's plan. God just takes over for real.
You'll find that the number one battle in life will always be identity. And even Jesus had to fight this battle. Jesus was led into the wilderness and Satan tempted him. And Satan said one thing: if you're the Son of God, then do this. And what Satan was trying to do was trying to get Jesus to operate outside of being a Son of God. The battle we're always going to be fighting is over our identities. And when Will cut off his dreads, that was awesome. That was huge because it was an identity shift. It was a surrender to relearning his new identity in Jesus Christ.
I offer my dreads and my hair. I offer my image what people have seen me as.
It's kind of a heavy thing. It was like we prayed over him and spoke words over him, edified him, and, you know, I think he's gonna get a lot out of it. I'm really excited for him, so we'll see what happens.
Thank you for the divine order that has been established right now through this act of worship and obedience, and we just call forth divine life right now to flood him and to fill him.
Next week on the 4040.
Yeah, we went and hiked to Blair Point.
Day three. Having good times.
It's no bake cookies that we failed to make no bake cookies.
Go, man!
It was kind of disheartening because we were really looking forward to being out, not being stuck in a tent during a lightning storm.
We're putting up our tents and thundering and rain.
It had no longer become a safe zone.
The bottom of our tent is basically a waterbed.
We got two blister actions going over here. Yeah, team!
Just give up the praise and glory to him no matter really what's happening, because we're still out on a great adventure.
We didn't eat anything like that. Where does that come from?
Here, just throw some more rice on there.
There's like just some bit.
You're fine.
Some bit.
Oh yeah, we totally make
it. Don't look at it. I'm sorry for my farting, but we all do it. It's okay. Open your mouth. I laughed so hard that I farted. It's classic.
Yeah!
It's still there! Why is the point of stopping?
Do it again!
Good job. That was like old water.